It's really banks on the move, and how this afternoon suddenly stirring to life. I think Anuj was just talking about umpteen number of coffees to get things moving. I think the market heard you, Anuj.
Yes.
But back in just a second, I do want to discuss the spike with you. Let's get some trading ideas in. Sandeep Wagle is also with us. Sandeep, happy new year to you. What are you trading this afternoon, first day of the new year?
Thanks, Surbhi. Wish you the same. I would be buying an Escorts, a clear breakout, stop loss of 707, target of 732, and a sell in a M&M, stop loss of 783, target of 756.
Okay, all right. Thanks, Sandeep, for that. So, Anuj, as I was saying, I think the market's heard your call. All the cups of coffee are working. Suddenly, there's some excitement here.
You know, the last 10 or 15 minutes, very interesting. Like Ms. Tulsian also pointed out, Escorts scoring over M&M. Right. Last year was about M&M catching up with Escorts and, you know, huge outperformance of M&M, especially towards the second half. You know, the general belief is that perhaps this 2019 is going to be a year where some of the beaten down good quality mid-cap stocks will make a comeback. Of course, Escorts is part of that list. You know, there are many such stocks, Surabhi. So that way, I think the mid-cap market is doing well. And also the Bank Nifty consistently is outperforming the IT index. I think that's one other move. You know, last year was all about IT, especially in the first half. You started to see from October onwards some move back into the domestic stocks. I think that's getting more and more traction now. Look at the way that index is moving today. Again, you know, we want to say that, you know, this is low volume trade, so you just want to see whether there's follow up tomorrow and going forward. But obviously the Nifty is still in that zone where it's seeing some congestion, but the Bank Nifty is offering perhaps a much cleaner play of late. And in the mid caps, I think you're seeing beaten down good quality names staging quite a bit of comeback.
One of them, I mean, quality or not, I mean, let me get our guests in on it, but it's definitely a very big stock. CG Power, for instance, is now surging 2% on the upside on CG Power. And a couple of the PSU banks are also now joining the party. They're saying, why only private sector banks? We want to be counted. So BOB, OBC, PNB for that matter, a lot of the PSU banking names are also getting excited. I don't think there's a movement on the yield, by the way. Let's just follow the 10-year bond yield. Last time I checked, it was still around 7.43. Yeah, so it's not as if there's been a major decline in the yields that could be perhaps triggering this. But anyhow, let's get the conversation back to the guests then. Mr. Tulsian, a stock like CG Power, again, it's flatter to deceive last several months. Would you give it any benefit of doubt? What would your call be on CG Power now?
See, Surabhi, post their Q2 numbers, you know, we have been giving, in fact, initiating the buy call on the stock, saying that it has bottomed out. For the reason that if you see their overseas operations now, all have turned EBITDA positive. And year round, they've stopped the monetization. Their last, I think, monetization has happened for the Hungary unit. And now if you take a call on their Belgium, Indonesia, everything has turned EBITDA positive. So you won't be having any exceptional losses. You won't be having any losses from the discontinued operation going forward. Probably the Q2 has booked the final losses from the discontinued and exceptional of about 70-80 crores. Now, if you take a call on the EV2 sales, the company is having a top line of closure to about 6,000 crore and market cap is 3,000 crore. The debt is not seen to be much. If you net off all the receivables and the value of the other units and all sort of things, probably the debt is less than 500 crore. So your EV is less than 0.5 against the capital goods company. If I'm taking the comparable peers like ABB, Siemens, GE Power, they are all ruling at EV to sales of 4 times to 6 times, while this stock is ruling at 0.5. So the profitability is just a matter of time, which will come and which will get reflected in the next maybe 6 to 18 months. Because even on the power system and the industrial system, on both the segments, companies doing exceptionally well. Railway seem to be a big kicker for them on the earning potential. So still, I think that if you really want to take the safe call and in fact, yesterday in the morning show, I recommended CG Power also as a stock for 2019, where we have been positive view with minimal downside and very good upside potential from here on. Over next 12 to 18 months.
Okay, I tell you something, that's a very good number from Eicher Motors. It's not the fact that it's up 2%. The December CVC is at 6,236 units. The market was actually pricing in, Surabhi, I think a degrowth.
Decline, yeah.
The market was pricing in a number which is much lower than the
5,600 is one of the estimates that we have.
5,600 was a number that the market was pricing in, and they have delivered 6,236 units. And I think they, Aishar has a lot of shorts as well. Over the last two or three days, I think a lot of people have gone short on Aishar Motors. And it won't surprise me if you now begin to, you know, see quite a bit of short covering on the stock, because this looks like a decent number. Of course, we're still expecting Royal Enfield sales numbers, but the commercial vehicle sale number is quite good on Aishar Motors. Ms. Tulsian, first thoughts. Of course, we have only the CV sales numbers right now from Aishar Motors.
Anuj, I agree that the CV sales numbers are seen to be quite good, but I don't think that that will really be the driver for the company to really take a call on, because the Royal Enfield numbers are seen to be quite important. And if you see YOY and MOM, you know, they have sales of about 66,000 to 67,000 vehicles. So they have to at least, you know, come to the closure to those levels. If they show anything less than 67, 68,000 sales for this month, then probably that will be disappointment. So because CV sales has a very small percentage, maybe in terms of the operations or maybe in terms of the financial performance. So my eyes will be more on Royal Enfield, and I agree that the CV sales has been seen better. And in fact, that got slight indications from the sales of the Atul Auto also. I'm not saying that both are comparable, because SML Isuzu has again posted the flattish kind of results. In fact, they've shown a degrowth of 16% on a YOY basis, though for entire Q3 they've shown good numbers. So still, one cannot take a call that CV segments is not is likely to disappoint going forward.
Okay, all right, Mr. Tulsian, we'll wrap up the conversation on that note. Thank you very much for being with us this afternoon, and a very happy new year once again to you. We will see you, of course, tomorrow and through the course of the year.
You know, what this Aishar Motors sales number has done is just pull out a stock like Ashok Leyland. I think that's where, because, you know, at least we got the CV sales from a big company now, and the market would want to believe that perhaps
even it might not be as bad for Ashok Leyland.
Well, and that's why I think that's one stock where you're beginning to see quite a bit of price action. So that's something that you would want to keep on your radar. And I think those numbers should also come out soon. But for now, that's one stock where, again, you know, in the morning there were a lot of shorts and they are being covered right now.
Okay, so there's some hope floating as far as CV numbers go. Speaking of hope, there's a lot of hope around mid-caps and small-caps that indeed after a drubbing in 2018, 2019 will get the flair and the excitement back. Let's discuss that and more with our alpha manager of the day, Vineet Sambre, head of equities at DSP Investment Managers, is with us. Vineet, good afternoon and season's greetings. Wish you a very, very happy 2019. Happy New Year to you, to your entire team at DSP as well. Let me start with that million-dollar question. 15% down on the mid-cap index, 30% down on the small-cap index in 2018. Is 2019 going to be a year of the broader market, mid-caps and small-caps?
Okay, good afternoon, and wish you all a very happy new year, the team CNBC. Coming on to the question on mid-caps, surely we have seen a decent correction in the mid-caps and more so in the small-caps, and that has made the category look slightly more reasonable and the valuations have become much more sensible. So it's a good starting point. The sense now what we have is that as we are entering into 2019 with a lot of the events which we are carrying it forward from 2018, which are linked to probably the general election or the international news around US-China trade related issues, US increasing the interest rate. I think those are going to keep the volatility very high. The sense is that as these stocks have corrected down, may probably correct furthermore given the volatility going ahead in the first half. The opportunity set is going to emerge. That should be a good starting point to look at some of these mid-caps. Whether they will outperform in 2019, it's a very difficult call, but over the next 3-4 years, definitely it makes a lot of sense as these stocks are correcting and coming down to reasonable valuations.
Vineet, hi, good afternoon, and happy new year to you from my side as well. What about the kind of stocks that you think will generate returns from here? The entire mid-cap market has corrected, but October to December has been a good period. Market breadth consistently has been good, at least for last fortnight or last 1 month or so, and a lot of domestic stocks making a comeback. So in terms of your portfolio stance, do you think you'll be making a lot of changes, or will you be sticking on to the stocks that you have and adding perhaps?
So by and large, what we are doing, wherever we have high conviction on our existing sectors, we continue to add to those. And typically where we are positive right now, given the current environment, low inflationary environment, we expect the interest rate to remain low. Due to the upcoming election, we also expect a lot of the dole outs which will be given out, especially in the rural sector. So I think the categories which are linked to some of these segments of the economies, those are expected to do well. And in line with those, we have our positive stance on consumer discretionary. We continue to remain positive on the banking sector, given the interest rate environment is low, liquidity is improving, and the credit cost environment is also becoming more favorable for the banking sector overall. Along the line, we are also positive, as I mentioned, a lot of schemes likely to be given to the rural segment of the economy. So the sectors which are linked directly and indirectly to the rural side, those are the ones to look forward to. So I think those are the really the bets which we are looking on and trying to build more in our mid-cap and the small-cap portfolios.
Mm. So Vineet, how exactly are you playing this rural sort of theme up to the elections? Is it only through FMCG stocks? Is it through two-wheelers? Or is it through, I'm just trying to understand how you're actually playing this out in the portfolio, in specifically in the mid-cap and small-cap arena, because the two-wheeler stocks, are in the large-cap category.
Yeah, so you're right. What we're trying to do within the auto space, it is auto ancillary, which we try to indirectly play the whole theme, which is linked to the rural side of the economy. There is also the whole spectrum of the financial space, which is by and large also catering to the rural side of the economy, which is going to be also beneficiary of the theme, and those type of companies. Along the side, we are also looking at some of the improvement in the capex place, so cement, materials, agrochemicals. So I think a combination of some of these segments is what we are really bullish about.
Okay, the market's making one more move now on the Nifty, again trying to get into that 10,900 sort of zone. And of course, HDFC has helped it, but other stocks as well are doing well right now. Even some of the beaten down stocks like Bharti Airtel trying to make a bit of a comeback. Just pull out that stock intraday and you will see that. So that one also looking quite good. Apart from that, just pull out Ultratech Cement's intraday chart. That one right now seeing some gains. So just see the stock. That is making a big move towards the high point of the day. ICICI Bank, HDFC Twins, of course, really doing the bulk of heavy lifting over the last few minutes. HDFC itself is at the HPCL pulled out that stock intraday, and there you're seeing quite a bit of gains. That's HDFC, of course. Now pull out HPCL, that's also making a move. So big moves happening right now as far as some of these individual stocks are concerned. Vineet, going forward, what's the biggest risk for this market? It's crude, which played spoil spot for a large part of the year. That at least is now behaving itself. We have domestic issues like elections in May. Your thoughts on what's going to be the biggest risk factor?
See, the biggest risk, per se, if we look at the last 3-4 years, it has really been the macro rally which has driven the markets by and large and the flows in the market. And in terms of the corporate sector growth, that is still lacking. There have been disappointment in terms of the earnings growth. Next year, if you were to ask us what are going to be the biggest risk, I think if it is again going to be a disappointing year in terms of the earnings, I think that's going to be a big risk for the markets, because it is the high earnings which is basically leading to high earnings expectation, which is leading to some reasonableness in the valuation. And if these were to disappoint, I think those will continue to sort of lead to further downgrades in terms of the market. So I think earnings is going to be one side of the risk. And the other, as I mentioned, flows has been quite positive for the last 2-3 years, which has led to this premium valuation for many categories. Some of the categories, have reached historical highs in terms of the valuations. So if flows were to sort of get sucked out of the system, I think that can be the second level of risk as far as the whole market is concerned.
Well, well, what do you know? When the cat is away, the mice play. That's the saying. 10,900 is back on the screen. But I guess the Bulls would want to believe that this is not going to vanish tomorrow or, you know, over the next 2-3 days when players come back, right?
Look, you should not have extrapolated the first half of today. You should not extrapolate the second half of today. That's the limited point. just sort of, you know, enjoy this move, think of it as some kind of perhaps a Netflix show or something. the real move for the market, of course, will happen, I think, from tomorrow. Once, you know, you have some kind of decent volume come back, you have some kind of global market as well. At least we can measure whether, you know, we are, that's one point though, Surabhi, that, you know, you would have noticed December was about stark India outperformance compared to the other emerging market. I think that's something which should keep the market in good stead, that there's something changing for Indian market. You know, started to see a decent period of outperformance, not just a weekly outperformance. For last 3 months now, we have outperformed the global peers quite a bit.
I take that point, yes. I think we'll only have the answers in the next 3-4 days when there's, you know, more participation coming back in. For now, for what it's worth, I mean, it's a screen that reads 10,900. Vinita, I just want to talk about one theme that you've particularly liked in the last couple of months, and that is chemicals. And this is a very complicated play. A lot of it is China-related. Are you still as confident, though I know it's going to be very stock-specific and company-specific, but are you still as confident, is that whole China story and the shutting down of sort of polluting capacities, etc., is that still a play for 2019? And do you expect specialty chemical companies to continue doing so well?
So that theme seems to have been playing. If we just go by the last 2 quarters results of some of the large companies within the segment, they have started outperforming themselves in terms of the numbers. And this is by and large what we hear as a commentary from the management is, you know, it is linked to many factors, and one important factor being the China factor. So to us, we feel that this is likely to continue next year as well. These companies have started reporting good numbers, decent numbers, and hopefully this continues going forward. So that's our expectation and belief, and which is where we have a decent share of weight in our small cap fund to this category.
Vinit, the mid cap pharma has done well for you, especially stocks like Divi's Labs. The problem is it's perhaps going to enter the large cap category soon enough, and that could be the case with a couple of other stocks as well. But I mean, that's a different issue altogether, of course. But you know, you have decent weight in pharma. You stick to that despite the kind of outperformance that we've seen.
So by the way, DVS has already got into the large cap universe by now. In terms of the other pharma bets, I think selectively we are positive on the healthcare sector. What we are witnessing, I've been saying this for a while now, companies which were actually facing the problem of the US FDA plant related issues, some of them have started coming out of those. The US pricing environment still continues to remain a bit pressurizing, but we feel that we are towards the end of the problem even there. I mean, the velocity of the problem, the price decline is sort of abated in the US markets. So I think selectively it makes sense to look at the pharmaceutical universe. By and large, as a house or as well, we are either equal weight or overweight pharma in a few of our schemes.
Well, okay, Vinit, thanks very much. Before we let you go, just last question from my side. If you're talking about the one big theme of 2019, which theme would you go with? Would it continue to be rural consumption? Anything else that comes to mind?
So I think rural consumption is more linked to the election in the first half. But if you were to really pin down to one big theme, I think it's going to be the corporate sector banking segment, where definitely the earnings delta is going to be very high. Given that you know, these banks are emerging out of their problems, the credit cost is likely to go down and the growth is picking up. So I think that's one big category. And even if we were to look at the expectation of earnings growth for FY20, a big chunk of contribution is coming out because of the delta from the corporate sector banks.